Hello guys, welcome to the presentation of Chapter 8, which material is about tapping into global markets. Let's take a look at table of contents that we'll talk about. First is about our team members' introduction, then after that is all the materials of Chapter 8, which we are gonna explain to you one by one. There are 5 sub-chapters in total. First, competing on global basis, deciding whether to go abroad, deciding which market to enter, deciding how to enter the market, and last, deciding on the marketing program. Okay, so our team is consists of 3 members, Theresia, Hanson, and Clara. Next, we will discuss the first material, competing on global basis. Global industry is an industry in which strategic position of competitors in major geographic or national market are fundamentally affected by their overall global position. A global firm itself can operate in more than one country and captures research and development, production, logistical, marketing, and financial advantage in its cost and reputation that are not available to purely domestic competitors. Global firms plan, operate, and coordinate their activities on a worldwide basis. For example, Otis Elevator uses their system from France, small gear part from Spain, electronics from Germany, and motor drives from Japan, while the system integration happens in United States. Next material is deciding whether to go abroad. If the domestic market were large enough, most companies would prefer to remain domestic, since the business would have been easier and safer. For example, managers would not need to learn other language and laws, face political and legal uncertainties, or redesign their products to suit different customer needs and expectations. Yet, several factors can draw companies into the international arena, such as, first, some international markets present better profit opportunities than the domestic market. 2. The company needs a larger customer base to achieve economics of scale. 3. The company wants to reduce its dependence on any one market. 4. The company decides to counterattack global competitors in their home market. 5. Customers are going abroad and require international service. Before entering the global markets, there are some risks the company might face in the future, such as, first, the company might not understand foreign preference and could fail to offer a competitively attractive product. 2. The company might not understand the foreign country's business culture. 3. The company might underestimate foreign regulation, which lead to unexpected costs. 4. The company might lack managers with international experience. As we know, domestic and international markets are different in several aspects. 5. The foreign country might change its commercial laws, devalue its currency, or undergo a political revolution and expropriate foreign property. By calculating those risks above before entering the global markets, it will decrease the percentage of potential risks that company might face. And then, the internationalization process itself has 4 stages. First, no regular export activities. It deals with as no regular export activities in new market, and knowing the market by experimental learning, which helps in utilization of resources in effective ways. Sporadic export is one of the example. 2. Export via independent representative. Most firms work with an independent agent and enter a nearby or similar country. They establish an export department to manage its agent relationships. 3. Establishment of one or more sales subsidiaries. Firm replaces agents with its own sales subsidiaries in its larger export market. This increases both investment and risk, but also creates potential. Then, to manage subsidiaries, the company replaces the export department with an international department of division. For example, a big company like Amazon owns many subsidiary companies such as Zappos, Shopbop, Goodreads, TeachTrade, and IMDb. 4. Establishment of production facilities abroad. If markets are large and stable, or the host country requires local production, the company will locate production facilities there. For example, Nike has production facilities in many countries. Next, deciding which market to enter. First, we have to decide how many markets to enter. The company must decide how many countries to enter and how fast to expand. The company must also choose the countries to enter based on product and on factors such as geographic, income, population, and political climate. 2. Evaluating the potential markets. There are many ways to evaluate the market, such as first, urgency. How badly do people want to need this? 2. Market size. How many people are actively purchasing things like this? 3. Pricing potential. What is the highest average price a purchaser would be willing to spend for a solution? 4. Cost of customer acquisition. How easy it is to acquire a new customer? 5. Cost of value delivery. How much will it cost to create and deliver the value offered, both in money and effort? 6. Uniqueness of offer. How unique is your offer versus competing offerings in the market, and how easy is it for potential competitors to copy you? Next is speed to market. How quickly can you create something to sell? Next, upfront investment. How much will you have to invest before you are ready to sell? Next, upsell potential. Are there related secondary offers that you could also present to purchasing customers? And last, evergreen potential. Once the initial offer has been created, how much additional work will you have to put it in order to continue selling? Then at last, if the company managed to do the two steps above, they will success in developing the market.
So now we're going to talk about deciding how to enter the market. There are so many ways to entering the market, such as indirect exporting, licensing, joint ventures, direct investment, and acquisitions. Each succeeding strategy entails more commitment, risk control, and profit potential. So the first one, we're going to talk about indirect exporting. Companies typically start with export, specifically indirect exporting. Indirect exporting means they are working through independent intermediaries. So first, domestic best export merchants buy the manufacturers' products and then sell them abroad. After that, domestic best export agents, including trading companies, seek and negotiate foreign purchases for a commission. And then, cooperative organizations conduct exporting activities for several producers, often of primary products such as fruits or nuts, and are partly under their administrative control. After that, export management companies agree to manage a company's export activities for a fee. Next is direct exporting. Companies may eventually decide to handle their own export. The investment and risk are somewhat greater, but so is the potential return. Direct exporting means that the company handling their own exports. Direct exporting happens in several ways. First, domestic best export department. This is a pure service function that may evolve into a self-contained export department operating as its own profit center. The second is overseas sales branch or subsidiary. So the sales branch handles sales and distribution and perhaps warehousing and promotion as well. It often serves as a display and customer service center. The third is traveling export sales representative. So the home-based sales representatives travel abroad to find business. And the last one is the foreign-based distributors or agent. These third parties can hold limited or exclusive rights to represent the company in that country. The third and the fourth, we're going to talk about licensing and joint ventures. Licensing is the licensor uses a license to a foreign company to use a manufacturing process, trademark, patent, trade secret, or other item of value for a fee or royalty. In contract manufacturing, the firm hires local manufacturers to produce the product. Finally, a company can enter a foreign market through franchising, a more complicated form of licensing. The franchisor offers a complete brand concept and operating system. In return, the franchise invests in and pays certain fees to the franchisors. And then, next is joint ventures. So the foreign investors have often joined local investors in a joint venture company in which they share ownership and control. A joint venture may be necessary or desirable for economic or political reasons. The foreign firm might lack of the financial, physical, or managerial resources to undertake the venture alone, or the foreign government might require joint ownership as a condition for entry. And the fifth is direct investment. The foreign company can buy part or full interest in a local company or build its own manufacturing or service facilities. If the market is large enough, direct investment offers distinct advantages. First, the firm secures cost economics through a cheaper labor or raw materials, government incentive, and freight savings. The second, the firm strengthens its image in the host country because it creates jobs. Third, the firm deepens its relationship with the government, customers, local suppliers, and distributors, enabling it to better adapt its products to the local environment. The fourth, the firm retains full control of its investment and can develop manufacturing and marketing policies that serve its long-term international objectives. The fifth, the firm ensures its access to the market in case the host country insists that locally purchased goods must have domestic content. And the last one is acquisition. Acquisition means that we acquiring local brands for their brand portfolio. Rather than bringing their brands into certain countries, many companies choose to acquire local brands for their brand portfolio. Strong local brands can tap into customer sentiment in a way international brands may find it difficult.
Now we will discuss about deciding on the marketing program. The subtopic in deciding on the marketing program is global similarities and differences, marketing adaptation, global product strategies, global communication strategies, global pricing strategies, and global distribution strategies. First of all, international companies must decide how much to adapt their marketing strategy to local conditions. At one extreme is the standardized marketing program worldwide, which promises the lowest cost. It has pros and cons, as you can see in the slide. In the advantage side, economies of scale in production and distribution, lower marketing costs, power and scope, consistency in brand image, ability to leverage and put ideas quickly and efficiently, uniformity of marketing practices. In the disadvantage side, ignores differences in consumer needs, wants, and usage patterns for products. ignores differences in consumer response to marketing programs and activities, ignores differences in the legal environment, ignores differences in marketing institutions, and ignores differences in administrative procedures. At the other extreme is an adapted marketing program in which the company, consistent with the marketing concept, believe consumer needs very and tailored marketing to its target group. It also has pros and cons. In the advantage side, customers can keep their landmark and feel noticed. Excellent global image and meet global specifications and expectations. In the disadvantage side, higher cost, time-consuming and poor speed of execution and difficulty to know what consumers really want. We are going on the first two topics, global similarities and differences. Consumer behavior may reflect cultural differences that can be pronounced across countries. Hofstede identifies four cultural dimensions that differentiate countries. The first one is individualism versus collectivism. In collectivist societies, the self-worth of an individual is rooted more in the social system than in individual achievement. For example, high collectivism in Japan and low collectivism in the United States. Second is high versus low power distance. High power distance cultures tend to be less egalitarian. For example, high egalitarian in Russia and low egalitarian in Nordic countries. Third is masculine versus feminine. This dimension measures how much the culture reflects assertive characteristic more often attributed to males versus nurturing characteristic more often attributed to females. For example, highly masculine in Japan and low masculine in Nordic countries. And the last is weak versus strong uncertainty avoidance. Uncertainty avoidance indicates how risk-averse people are. For example, high avoidance in Greece and low avoidance in Jamaica. Consumer behavior differences, as well as historical market factors, have led marketers to position brands differently in different markets. For example, Heineken beer is a high-end super premium offering in the United States, but more middle of the road in its Dutch home market. Honda automobiles denote speed, yacht, and energy in Japan, and quality and reliability in the United States. We're going on the second subtopic, marketing adaptation. Because of all the differences that we discussed before, most products require at least some adaptation. Even Coca-Cola is sweeter or less carbonate in certain countries. Rather than assuming it can introduce its domestic product as is in another country, a company should review the following elements and determine which add more revenue than cost if adapted. As you can see in the slide, product features, labeling, colors, materials, sales promotion, prices, advertising media, brand name, packaging, advertising execution, and advertising themes. Companies must make sure their brands are relevant to consumers in every market they enter. I take an example from McDonald's global menu variations. You can pause the video to see in detail. The third subtopic is global product strategies, which have three main points: product standardization, product adaptation strategies, and brand element adaptation. We are going to discuss about product standardization. It refers to the process of maintaining uniformity and consistency among the different iterations of a particular good or service that are available in different markets. The uses of product standardization is cost reduction, production efficiency, establishment and strengthening of the brand, convenience of for consumers and standard of quality. Some products cross borders without adoption better than others, and consumer knowledge about new products is generally the same everywhere because perceptions have yet to be formed. High-end products also benefit from standardization because quality and prestige often can be marketed similarly across countries. Culture and wealth factors influence how quickly a new product takes off in a country. Hog adoption and diffusion rates are becoming more alike across countries over time. Food and beverage marketers find it more challenging to standardize. Of course, given widely varying tastes and cultural habits, French food company Danone has many high-end healthy products such as Danone yogurt, Evian water, and Blenina baby food. But it also sells much lower-priced products targeting consumers with dollar-a-day food budgets. Danone now generates over 60% of its sales from growth markets, up from just 23% in 1996. Next is product adaptation strategies. Warren Keegan has distinguished 5 product and communications adaptation strategies. As you can see in the picture, strike extension introduced the product in the foreign market without any change. Tempting because it required no additional R&D expense, manufacturing retooling, or promotional modification. The strategy has been successful for cameras, consumer electronics, and many machine tools. In other cases, it has been a disaster. Campbell Soup Company lost an estimated $30 million in producing condensed soup in England. Consumers saw expensive small-size cans and didn't realize water needed to be added. Product adaptation. Alters the product to meet local conditions or preferences. Flexible manufacturing makes it easier to do so on several levels. The first level is a company can produce a regional version of its product. Dunkin' Donuts has been introducing more regionalized products, such as Chocolate Donut in Miami and Sausage Colleges in Dallas. Second, a company can produce a country version. Kraft blends different coffees for the British, who drink coffee with milk, the French, who drink it black, and Latin Americans, who want a chicory taste. The third is a company can produce a city version, for instance, a beer to meet Munich's or Tokyo's taste. And the last is a company can produce different retailer versions, such as one coffee brew for the Migros chain store and another for the cooperative chain store, both in Switzerland. Product invention. Create something new. It can take two forms, backward and forward. Backward invention reintroduce earlier product forms well adapted to a foreign country's needs. Forward invention creates a new product to meet a need in another country. Less developed countries need low-cost, high-protein foods. Companies such as Quaker Oats have researched their nutrition requirements, formulated new foods, and developed advertising to gain product trial and acceptance. Changing market communications for its local market is a process called communication adaptation. If it adapts both the product and the communications, the company engages in dual adaptation. Next is brand element adaptation. When they launch products and services globally, marketers may need to change certain brand elements. Numbers and colors can take on special meaning in countries. For example, the number 4 is considered unlucky throughout much of Asia, because the Japanese word sounds like death. Some East Asian buildings skip not only the fourth floor, but often every floor that has the four in it, like 14, 24, 40, 49. Nokia doesn't release phone models with the number 4 in them in Asia. Purple is associated with death in Burma and some Latin American nations. White is a mourning color in India. And in Malaysia, green connotes descent. Red generally signifies luck and prosperity in China. Brand slogans or ad taglines sometimes need to be changed too. For example, when Coors puts its brand slogan, "Turn it loose," into Spanish, some read it as "suffer from diarrhea." We are going to the next subtopic, global communication strategies, which include global adaption. Companies that adapt their communication style with a number of challenges. First, they must ensure their communications are legally and culturally acceptable. Firms next must check their creative strategies and communication approaches for appropriateness. Companies also must be prepared to vary their message appeal. When the brand is at an earlier stage of development in its new market, consumer education may need to accompany brand development efforts. Personal selling tactics may need to change too. For example, the direct no-nonsense approach favored in the US, like "let's get down to business and what's in it for me," may not work as well in Europe or Asia as an indirect, subtle approach. The next subtopic is global pricing strategies. There are price escalation, transfer prices, gray markets, and counterfeit products. Price escalation. Companies have three choices for setting prices in different countries. First, set a uniform price everywhere. PepsiCo might want to charge $1 for Pepsi everywhere in the world, but then it will earn quite different profit rates in different countries. Also, this strategy would make the price too high in poor countries and not high enough in rich countries. Next is set a market-based price in each country. PepsiCo will charge what each country could afford. But this strategy ignores differences in the actual cost from country to country. It could also motivate intermediaries in low-price countries to reshift their Pepsi to high-price countries. And the last is set a cost-based price in each country. Here, PepsiCo would use a standard markup of its cost everywhere, but this strategy might price it out of market where its costs are high. Next is transfer price. Transfer price is the price at which the related parties transact with each other, such as during the trade of supplies or labor between departments. Transfer prices are used when individual entities of a larger multi-entity firm are traded and measured as separately run entities. It is common for multi-entity corporations to be consolidated on a financial reporting basis. However, they may report each entity separately for tax purposes. A transfer price can also be known as a transfer cost. Next is gray market versus counterfeit products. Gray goods are legitimate goods that come from the correct manufacturer, but they are sold through unauthorized channels. While these are not illegal goods, it is important to be wary of them. Sellers who use the gray market will usually sell products that have been improperly discarded due to the make of or product recall. Whereas counterfeit goods are phony products that are designed to mimic trademarked products, without the consent of the original manufacturer. The products themselves are not illegal, but the way they are marketed is. Often, these goods can be difficult to identify, which is how they go unnoticed in the gray market in the first place. Now we will go in the last subtopic, global distribution strategies. There are channel entry and channel differences. In channel entry, there are three links between the seller and the final buyer. In the first, seller international marketing headquarters, the export department or international division, makes decisions about channels and other marketing activities. The second link, channels between nations, gets the products to the borders of the foreign nation. Decisions made in this link include the types of intermediaries, type of transportation and financing and risk management. The third link, channels within foreign nations, gets product from their entry point to final buyer and users. Next is channel differences. Distribution channels across countries vary considerably. To sell consumer products in Japan, companies must work through one of the most complicated distribution systems in the world. They sell to a general wholesaler, who sells to a product wholesaler, who sells to a product specialty wholesaler, who sells to a regional wholesaler, who sells to a local wholesaler, who finally sells to retailers. Taking this same consumer product to tropical Africa, the company might sell to an import wholesaler who sells to several jobbers, who sell to pretty traders, mostly women, working in local markets.
Okay, now we're going to talk about the country of origin effects. It is a mental associations and beliefs that triggered by a country. So government officials want to strengthen their country's image to help domestic marketers that export and to attract foreign firms and investors. Marketers want to use positive country of origin perceptions to sell their products and services. Governments now recognize that the image of their cities and countries affect more than tourism and have important value in commerce. Foreign business can boost the local economy, provide jobs, and improve infrastructure. Image can also help sell products. Global marketers now know that the buyers hold distinct attitudes and beliefs about brands or products from different countries. This perception can be attributes in decision making or influence other attributes in the process. So I think we are now at the end of our chapter. Thank you guys for listening, and if you guys have any question, you can comment down below. Bye bye.